When Toyota first launched the first generation Highlander back in 2001, it took a bold risk by putting it on a unibody car platform when a lot of SUVs at the time were still body on frame trucks. Now in its fourth generation, the Highlander name has taken off. It's gotten a lot bigger since that original model. This new fourth generation 2020 model is larger in almost every dimension. It's longer, it's larger on the inside, it's more voluminous, but Toyota has says that this is now on their new TNGA platform, meaning it is lighter than the car it replaces, meaning it is more efficient. In fact, the hybrid version of this car is the most efficient 8-row passenger vehicle on sale today. So that is quite big. There can be only one fuel economy king, and it is this vehicle right here. Let's go ahead and check it out. Before we get it out on the road, let's talk a little bit about the styling changes, because this is a bold new styling direction, or at least so Toyota says, for this 2020 model year. We've got the new Toyota front fascia. It looks a little bit cleaner and nicer than the model it replaces. I think the side profile is especially good. You've got some really nice sort of flowing lines from the wheel arches. I do like how the wheel arches are a little bit squared off, although I wish they would have leaned into that a little bit more to make this look a little bit more rugged, like its compact sibling, the RAV4. So overall, I think this is a stylish car. This moonrock exterior is new for 2020. I think it looks really nice in this pretty blue. There are a couple other nice colors as well, but let's go ahead and get behind the wheel of the V6 model that we have here. No four-cylinder anymore, to see how it drives. All right, so we're gonna start off in the gasoline-powered Highlander, because that's the one Toyota says is going to be the bulk of the volume for sales. 80% of all Highlanders purchased, or at least in Toyota's estimation, are going to have this 3.5-liter V6 producing 295 horsepower and 263 foot-pounds of torque, or pound-feet, as some commenters like to tell me it's called. I think foot-pounds just sounds a little better. All of that is going to be mated through an 8-speed automatic to front-wheel drive or all-wheel drive. They actually have two different all-wheel drive systems depending on which trim level you buy on the gasoline model. Now, the engine here is very smooth. I've already driven the hybrid, and I'm going to talk a little bit more about that later, but I really like this V6, same one you'd get in like a Camry or an Avalon. I'm going to go ahead and floor it now. Sounds really nice. I think it is a little muted from the cabin, which is a good thing, so it never sounds like it's too stressed out, even when you mash the pedal, so you can easily get around traffic. Even though this is quite a large, heavy vehicle, you do have a couple of drive modes. I have it now in sport, and there's normal and eco mode as well. Changes the steering a little bit, the shift logic of the transmission, but nothing too crazy. As with the outgoing Highlander, the steering is very light, the ride is very supple. The road noise is a little bit high. I will say that's been a Toyota issue with a lot of their recent models. They've been a little bit loud on rougher roads, and this is no different. But I do think that this engine is very smooth and very quiet. And Toyota says that even though this new Highlander is larger and longer than the one it replaces, it's actually lighter because it's now on the TNGA platform. And because it's lighter, you're going to get pretty good fuel economy. On the highway, Toyota says that a front-wheel drive V6 Highlander can get up to, depending on trim level, 29 mpg. With all-wheel drive, it's going to be significantly less, about 2 or 3 mpg less. But it is still pretty efficient. It's actually more efficient than the Korean automakers, the midsize, like the Telluride and Palisade. But speaking of the Telluride and Palisade, I will say that the last time I drove the Telluride, we were driving it through Colorado on some really mountainous roads, and I just felt like the overall body composure of that car was better than this Highlander. When I chucked that thing through a corner, I never felt like I was going to get sick. I never felt like I was going to fall out of my seat. Now, in the Highlander, it's not like too bad, but it definitely feels a little more roly-poly. I can feel myself getting pulled out of the seat, and I can feel myself, and I can hear all of the loose items that we have in the car on this press drive kind of rolling around a bit more than I think I would get in either the Telluride or the Hyundai Palisade, because those cars are just fantastic. But again, this is a very compliant cruiser. We're sitting in a V6 Platinum trim with all-wheel drive, so we have the nicer interior. We did have a chance to drive a lower trim model LE, which is towards the bottom of the range. And aside from the cloth seats, which were still pretty comfortable, these leather ones are just really nice, really supple. You are going to feel very comfortable in this for a long period of time. And I do notice that some of the materials on this Platinum trim are a lot nicer, and you do get to pick from some nicer interior color options as well. So now that we've driven the V6, let's go ahead and drive the hybrid model, which instead of having a V6 gasoline engine on the hybrid, it now has a 4-cylinder, which means it doesn't feel quite as quick or as smooth as this buttery V6 gas engine one. So I've traded in the gas engine one. Now we're driving a hybrid model. We're driving the fully loaded Platinum with all-wheel drive. And the hybrid has changed significantly on this 2020 Highlander. Instead of a 3.5-liter V6 engine, you now get a 2.5-liter 4-cylinder engine that develops about 186 horsepower, but with the added assist of the batteries, you're gonna get 243 horsepower total. Now the big thing you're gonna notice about that number is it is less than what you get from the gas-engined Highlander, and it is much less than you used to get from the V6 Highlander hybrid from last year. And I asked Toyota why they decided to downsize the hybrid from a V6 to a 4-cylinder, and the main reason is customers wanted fuel economy. Fuel economy, fuel economy, fuel economy. And from that move from a V6 to a 4-cylinder, Toyota has managed to get best-in-class fuel economy out of this vehicle. The Platinum model that we're driving with all-wheel drive, wait for this, gets 35 mpg in the city, on the highway, and combined, you will average 35. The one I'm driving right now, we've only been doing some back road driving where I've been accelerating quite heavily, but it sits at 32.4, so I do very much believe that in the right circumstances, on the right road, you will average that 35 number, which is fantastic for a large through-row vehicle like this. Like I said, best in class. But you do have a little bit of drawback from opting for the hybrid model now because, like I mentioned, it is less powerful. So let's go ahead and put our foot down. Yes, it doesn't feel as fast as that gasoline model. Toyota says that 0 to 60, no matter which model you pick, is gonna sit around that 7.5-second figure, but you are going to feel a lot quicker in the gas engine model. Not too many differences to speak of between the two. The all-wheel drive system is a little bit different. When you opt for the hybrid all-wheel drive, you are getting an electric motor in the rear that's providing the all-wheel drive, whereas the two all-wheel drive systems in the gas engine model are a little more conventional. You get a Toyota's weird eco power charge gauge instead of a tachometer, and aside from that, the two do feel very similar. You do get an eCVT transmission instead of an 8-speed automatic if you opt for this hybrid model. And the hybrid model does come at a premium, so you are going to be opting for it for fuel economy and not for power on this trim, which is different than the RAV4 hybrid, which is actually more powerful than the gasoline model. And I do prefer the RAV4 hybrid. I think this drivetrain makes a little bit more sense in a smaller package like that. You can get about 40 mpg. But I do think that if you're doing long journeys with the kids in this car, the hybrid RAV4 does start to make a lot of sense. That fuel economy is fantastic, and Toyota says you should get over 600 miles on a tank of gas out of this. So again, not the faster of the two models, but if you want the most efficient one, it's the hybrid you're gonna wanna go for. So now let's go ahead and pull over, and Toyota has a bunch of trim levels of Highlander. So let's start off with a lower trim model, you know, which I think a lot of people are gonna be looking at, and then we'll take a look at one of the higher trims like this Platinum. Now that we're pulled over, I wanted to start by showing you a mid-level trim. This is the XLE hybrid that we're in. You can distinguish the hybrid because instead of a traditional tachometer, we have a eco, charge, and power gauge, as Toyota has been doing for years on their hybrid models. Now, unless you opt for the platinum trim, or I believe it's optional on some of the other trims, you're going to be getting this smaller 8-inch display. It looks a lot like the one you would get in a Corolla or a Camry with all of these buttons around the side here. It does have Apple CarPlay, Android Auto, and Alexa integration as standard. You get your sort of climate controls right here, dual zone, or actually single zone, but it is automatic here. Now let's go ahead and step into a nicer platinum trim where the XLE does have leather, but you do get a little bit nicer leather with heating and ventilation and a few other goodies on the highest platinum trim. So now that we've checked out a lower tier Highlander, let's go ahead and check out the platinum trim interior. You're gonna notice right away this big 12.3 inch screen is much larger than what you're gonna get in a base model. You're also gonna get controls for your heated and ventilated seats. I like these big, large volume and tuning knobs here. And the thing that I really like about this latest generation of Entune display is that it's so large, you're gonna see your clear, concise, controls over here. If I go ahead and push map, you're going to get a nice clear color map. And then over here, you're going to have all of your side controls for audio, seat, ventilation, and things like that. And now you may be thinking, well, isn't that going to be hard for the passenger to reach? Well, Toyota has thought of that. You can push this button, and now the main part of the screen is on the driver's side, and now the other part of the screen is on the passenger side. I think that is pretty darn clever. Now, you're also going to get a little storage area down here with a little pass through right here, so you can run a cable from one of the three USB ports here up into this little area. But Toyota has decided to segment this. It used to be one piece all the way across the dash so the passenger could have their stuff over there. Now it's a little bit smaller. It goes up here and it's disconnected. I think that was a little bit of a mistake. You do also get storage down here, two cup holders, and then all of your controls for traction control, sport mode, mud and sand, rock and dirt, if you do plan to do any off-roading in this vehicle, which I don't think you will. A lot of the materials feel pretty soft and pretty plush. This dashboard is all soft touch. This is a little hard plastic. There are some hard plastics in here, and overall, I think the interior is very nice, although the Telluride and the Palisade interiors are a little bit better. You do also get a wireless charger right here in the center armrest, which has a slider to open, so it is not that difficult to access. Now let's go ahead and check out the back seats, where the Highlander, again, is a little bit smaller than its Korean competitors. So Toyota says you're going to get 40 inches of legroom up front, 41 inches back here, which is pretty good, but not as good as those Korean automakers, the Telluride and Palisade. And I hate to keep harping on it, but those are really good vehicles with a lot of space. You do have sliding seats back here, so you can go a little bit further back. We have the captain's chair option. You can get a bench seat back here so that you can fit up to 8 people. We have a higher trim example, so we do have heated seats back here. We have our own climate control. We have a AC volt as well as 2 charging USBs, and there is a nice little cup holder apparatus here. The seats themselves are pretty comfortable, and we do have a moonroof, but now I'm gonna go ahead and show you the third row. Let's see if I can even squeeze back here. Ugh, the headroom is not great in that second row, especially with the panoramic roof. And with those seats in their furthest back position, I really can't fit back here. It is really just for small children. I think if I did slide the seats up a little bit, I would have a little bit more room, but this is nowhere near as big as the Telluride or the Palisade. So let's go ahead and check out the cargo volume. Cargo hauling is obviously important in a midsize SUV like this. We've got a power liftgate here on this platinum trim. A lot of the trim levels do come with these power tailgates. Now, behind the third row, you're gonna get 16 cubic feet of storage, which opens up to about 48 cubic feet with the third row folded. And if you fold down the second row as well, you're gonna get a little over 84 cubic feet of storage. These are good numbers, although I will note, it is less than you'll get in the Kia Telluride and the Hyundai Palisade. Now let's go ahead and price out our fully loaded Toyota Highlander Platinum trim, but let's go over all of the pricing and trim levels that are available. Let's price out our all-new 2020 Toyota Highlander. I'm going to go through pricing for all the different trim levels for both front-wheel drive and all-wheel drive. So your base L trim is only available on the gasoline model, $34,600 for front-wheel drive, $36,200 for all-wheel drive. Now, it is worth noting that no matter whether you pick front-wheel drive or all-wheel drive, this is more expensive than its Korean competitors on the base end. And as we go up the trim levels, you're going to see that that remains such. Now, on the LE model, you're going to start at $36,800 for front-wheel drive, $38,400 for all-wheel drive. If you want the hybrid LE, it's going to be $38,200 for front-wheel drive or $39,800 if you want all-wheel drive. The XLE trim, which gets you a nicer leather interior and some other niceties, is going to start at $39,600, $41,200 for all-wheel drive, and the hybrid versions are $41,000 and $42,600 respectively. I think the XLE is going to make up a volume of the Highlander trims. Now the limited trim, which is a little bit nicer, that's going to be $43,650 for front wheel drive, $45,600 for all wheel drive, and for the hybrid models, it's going to be $45,050 for front wheel drive and $47,000 with all wheel drive. The fully loaded platinum trim that we drove starts out at $46,850, which is where you're starting to top out at with the Telluride and Palisade, $48,800 for all-wheel drive, and the hybrid models start at $48,250 for front-wheel drive and $50,200 respectively for all-wheel drive. So you can get these in the $50,000 range, which is quite expensive. There can be only one fuel economy king, and that is this Toyota Highlander. If you are looking for a three-row midsize SUV with the best fuel economy, it is this guy right here. In hybrid trim, you're going to get up to 36 mpg. That is a crazy amount of mpg in a vehicle of this size with this amount of cargo and people hauling capacity. But as I've shown you, the interior is a little bit nicer than the model it replaces. I like some of the changes in technology, and it drives pretty well. It just doesn't seem to be quite as dynamically sorted as the Korean competition, the Telluride and Palisade. So overall, I will point you to those cars because I think they do drive better and they are less expensive. This thing can top $50,000 with all-wheel drive and hybrid trim, so I do think it is a little bit expensive, but of course you are paying for that Toyota badge with the insane reliability. And if you're shopping for a Toyota, chances are you don't want to leave the Toyota brand, so you might not be willing to consider either of those two Korean options. And the big thing with the Telluride and the Palisade is neither one is available as a hybrid, meaning they cannot match the Highlander in terms of fuel efficiency. And if you liked this video and you'd like to see more, be sure to subscribe to the CarBuzz YouTube channel and hit the notification bell to be alerted of our latest videos. And be sure to check out the CarBuzz app on iOS and Android. That's where all of our latest news and reviews, like this Toyota Highlander review, always live. Hope you've enjoyed the video. See you next time.